This is a technology in the classroom. So we've been talking about kind of like the SAMR framework. And ultimately, their semester final is to create a letter of interest addressing some questions in a blog post and also include a lesson plan that they've enhanced through the use of technology integration.
Okay. Sounds
so
good.
That gives you an idea of their final, but we'll go ahead and let you two start going and introduce yourselves. Make sure you guys talk about your global connections and what you guys are doing with the different things. I know, Smoke, we go way back with your projects over at Andale and all there, so you can go way back, too, if you want.
Okay, well, I'm Dyane Smokorowski, but everybody just calls me Smoke, as he explained. It's just easier to remember than that crazy long name. I am currently a technology integration coach for the Andover schools. Anybody there from East Wichita Andover region in the room?
You do have one Bishop Carroll person in the room.
Close, you count, dude. It's all good. And so my job is to work with teachers who have or developing lesson plans kind of like yourselves and help them extend those projects out into something that's a little bit more higher level thinking. I have them connect on global levels quite often. We have everything from iPad to Chromebooks. You name it, we're going to find an opportunity to use it in the classroom. But it's really not about the device that we're going to put with kids' hands. It's about what experiences I want those kids to have. So if I want them to talk possibly to an author by chance, if we have a group of students who are in a language arts class, and, you know, how many of you really despise editing paper? Raise your hand if you're like, this is definitely not my favorite thing. Okay. Imagine that still happens on the K-12 level. Can you imagine that happening? Kids don't want to edit papers? Sound familiar? How many of you despised it in K-12? The same people. Okay, cool. We often will connect with an author who says, you know what? You guys know who Ridley Pearson is? Children's author?
No.
No? Okay, he wrote Peter and the Star Catchers. If you know that one, and he's done the Kingdom Keepers.
Kingdom Keepers series, yeah.
Yeah. He was one that Skyped with us last spring and shared with him that he and the comedian Dave Barry, they wrote the Peter and the Star Catchers book together. One would write one chapter, the other one would edit that person's chapter, and if he didn't like it, he could scrap the whole thing and rewrite it. But they went back and forth chapter by chapter, and basically the book is written 6 times before they get the final edit. So he says, you know, it's not just one edit of 150 words or, you know, 3 pages or however you go. This is an entire novel rewritten 6 times. And those books are a good 1.5 inches thick. So it's definitely work. And he told the kids, you know, it is hard, but there's a reason why you write with your heart first and then you go back and edit with your brain. Now, I come from middle school language arts. That's what I taught. But, you know, I can say 20 things 20 times, but until I hear it from somebody who does it for a living, well, then it's gold. So, you know, it's nice to connect those sort of experiences with students. Or if we want them to create an infographic or write a CEO company about a product they have, I mean, you just name it. We've tried just about everything from art to science to, we've even do engineering challenges. So, all kinds of opportunities. I'm also the 2013 Kansas Teacher of the Year, which means I get to nerd out a lot with pre-service teachers like yourselves across the state. So it's kind of cool to hang out with you guys today. And just have a super passion for global learning, as Mike does will. He'll tell you here in a little bit. I have been doing global collaboration projects since 2001, and I have worked on all 7 continents. Many times. We just finished our 7th continent about 3 weeks ago with a group of scientists in the Antarctic ice shelf. They're doing research. They talked to some 5th grade students about climate change. Not that they were saying it was happening or not happening. They just shared the data and says there's a reason why every 10 years we have to move our research lab or it will fall in the ocean. You tell us why. Those kinds of things. We also found out that they do not get supplies in their Antarctic base, but one time a year. Can you imagine no fresh vegetables or fruit for one solid year? Everything out of a can? That's crazy, right? And the coldest day of the year for them, of course, they have opposite seasons. So their winter is June, July, August. Their coldest day this June or July was -105. Yeah, it's too cold to snow. It's so cold. And they said, well, what's a warm day, we ask? And they're like, oh, -19. We go out in t-shirts, shorts. I'm like, you're kidding. Because compared to 105, -19 is balmy. And he talked about how these Adelie penguins walk from the ocean, which is a good, 30-mile walk, depending on which direction that they're coming from. And they walk up to see what the scientists are doing in their research. Like, what's going on? And how he hangs out with penguins. It was kind of cool. So, we connect with places all over the world. So that's just a little bit about me. Mike, tell them about yourself.
All right. So I'm Mike Soskil. I'm in Newfoundland, Pennsylvania, as you can see. My background is as a fifth grade teacher, especially as a math teacher. I won the Presidential Award for Excellence in Math Teaching a couple years ago. But like Dyane, I've ended up doing a lot of global collaboration recently. And that started because I believe that school should prepare kids for life. And when I went to school, it was awfully boring for me. I really didn't enjoy it all that much. And I sat there kind of bored, chewing on my fingernails with my arms crossed like some of you are doing right now, because it didn't engage me, And I became a teacher because I wanted to change that for my students. When you get out into the real world, and you guys have seen this, you're old enough, you're out of, high school and you're starting to see what the real world looks like. Life is about solving problems. Everything that you do for a job going forward is going to be some kind of problem that you're supposed to solve. It doesn't look like spitting back information in a textbook. And so, the way I ran my fifth grade classroom for the 16 years that I was a fifth grade teacher was to identify problems in the world, in our community, that we could solve, and then go ahead and solve them. But, recently, and you're taking a technology class, the world is based on technology. It's how the world works right now. So for us to not incorporate that into how we allow kids to solve problems would be a serious disservice to them and not be preparing them for life after they get out of our schools. And so in order to find the information they need to solve real problems, we've started connecting with experts and other classes for them to collaborate with, and that's led to some of the global collaborations that Dyane mentioned. So, our kids were interested in ocean life and seeing what they could do to protect our oceans. So we connected them with a shark expert in the Bahamas. We Skyped in and had a cultural exchange with kids in Kenya. And after seeing the condition of their classroom, my kids came to me and said, we want to do something about that. We want to help them. Their classroom doesn't look like ours. And so we put together a distance teaching project in which our fifth grade students are teaching through short videos using materials that we have in our school and kids in Kenya don't have. They're teaching them math concepts and they're modeling math. And that's expanded to, now we've got kids that have joined that project from France and kids in China who are teaching Asian art techniques. And it's become this global project, all because kids want to help each other and do good in the world. And, I think that if kids at young ages see the intrinsic joy of doing good, and they get that feeling that you all have done good for other people before. You know how it feels, but it feels good. If kids feel that early on, they grow up to be the kind of people that are going to change the world for the better. And I've seen that in my own students going forward so far and some of the things that we've done. And so I want to expose them to as many different, I should rephrase that. I want to have them identify problems in the world that they can solve and then empower them to solve them, so that they get that intrinsic joy that I talked about before. And that's kind of the crux of everything that I do in my classroom. And right now I have a job very similar to Dyane's, where I go in and basically I have K-5 teachers come to me, tell me what content they want to teach, and we find something extraordinary to do with it to make sure that it's a lesson that really resonates with students. And a lot of them is that global problem solving that I talked about before. So that's it in a nutshell. I'm sure we'll talk about more as we go forward.
All right, what questions did you guys have? Think of your own curriculum areas. Some of your PE, some of your health, some of your arts, some of your art teachers, some of your elementary. What would be some of the things that when you kind of your lesson plans and the integration of technology into your future classrooms, what are some of the other questions that you guys want to have? Think back to the Google surveys that you guys created and shared out asking questions. What would be some of those things that you want to ask? Because both of these guys are extremely open to it.
Well, Dean, can I ask a question of them?
Ask questions.
Yeah, so here's a question I would have for the class there. You know, think in your own lives, what problems do you want to solve? You know, what problems are you passionate about? That in what ways do you want to make the world better? And how can you share that passion with kids so that they can help you do good in the world? You know, think about those things in your own life that you care about doing good. You know, how do you want to make the world better? And how are you going to share that with students? And how can you turn it into a lesson? So throw some things out. You know, what are some things you guys care about? You know, like the rest of you, I'm not from Kansas. I'm actually, you know, originally from New York and from Pennsylvania. So the things you care about there might be different than the things for me. But.
Well, Mike, one came up he just mentioned was concussions.
Yeah, good. So, okay. So how can you turn, you know, trying to prevent concussions, and you know, I was a high school, or you know, I coached our high school girls varsity soccer team for 10 years, so that's a problem that I'm really familiar with. You know, how can we take preventing concussions and turn that into a lesson that teaches nonfiction reading, that teaches math, that teaches science, you know, incorporates the different subjects that you're going to go out and teach, you know, when you become teachers? How can we take solving that problem and turn it into something? So throw out some ideas. Let's brainstorm.
Well, nope, that works for physics. Good question for math.
But isn't math a form of isn't physics a form of math?
Yeah,
but that'd be dangerous. Yeah, I mean, you're saying you're not going to be able to teach physics?
No, I probably could, but I don't want to do, but I feel like that'd be overstepping my bounds.
throw that out. I think that's a good discussion. So I didn't quite catch all that, but tell me about physics.
You can figure out the exact force that it would take to cause someone a concussion, or the average force that it would take.
Okay, so we've got to talk about Newton's laws of motion and you know, some kind of physics concepts, which, you know, like I said, I'm an elementary teacher. As much as I love math, you know, high school physics math is probably, you know, beyond my area of expertise. But that doesn't mean that it's impossible for my fifth grade students to learn it. It just means that I'm going to have to bring in an expert that knows more about it than I do. So, you know, there's this beautiful thing called video conferencing, which is free and easy to do right now. If I need a physics expert to come and talk to my kids, I can find that instantly. I mean, I've got ways to do that. I can throw it out on Twitter or Facebook or use the Skype in the classroom website to find a physics expert that's going to talk about those forces. I can bring in a concussion expert that's, you know, that's working at a local hospital. And if they can't make it in to my school, you know, we can video conference them in. Those are, you know, that's easy. Those are easy problems to solve right there. So what else do we need to know if we're going to deal with concussions?
Well, to kind of go with your general question about things they're passionate about.
Yeah.
That's an ironic question because I didn't mention it to you, but that was their sole purpose. Open-ended essential question. There you go, Smoke. Essential question. For their digital story project, whether it was video or a digital story format. So what were some of your topics, folks? The topics you guys came up with, what were some of them? Okay, students want to make a change in the world. What's another?
Hugs are good for you.
Hugs are good for you.
Good.
You guys laugh. Seriously, it does make a huge difference. Homelessness. What are some of the other issues you guys talked about?
Childhood abuse.
Okay, childhood abuse.
Yeah.
Say what? Somebody just said something.
I'm reminded about my sister, power of
prayer. Okay, and the power of prayer. You know, obviously, your private school versus public school, there's a discussion, or even a public school versus another public school. I know we have that conversation in just briefly about my former school district compared to current school district. Here, that's an acceptable thing. In a former school district, it would never happen.
Well, you kind of giggled at the hugs one, but you've all seen those videos where somebody stands at the mall and he's holding the free hug sign and people come in and give hugs and they videotape all that. There's a math problem in that as well. You know what the ice bucket challenges that we saw last summer, right?
Yeah.
How many of you did it? See? Or 50%. There is a mathematical formula that actually shows the growth of hits on those videos and the number of funding that was coming to the ALS challenge to show how they not even quadrupled, but ridiculously increased their funding for the next year. And our math class, in a sixth grade math class, they followed the trajectory of that data and actually communicated with the local ALS chapter to show the power of what social media can do to raise money for charity, as well as, you know, make something good happen in the world. Well, those videos where somebody is holding a hug sign and somebody comes to hug them, or, you know, whatever they did, maybe it's high fives that are free or something. Could you do something similar like that on campus and just hold your hand up there and get high fives as people go by? That's possible, right?
Yeah.
It might be interesting to see the comparison of here's our population at Sterling College, here's the population of wherever that other one was, or, you know, if it's at the mall or wherever you want to go, maybe you come into Wichita and go to Town East at the height of Christmas season, giving people high fives. See if that doesn't also get some traction on the web. And compare that just a little bit. There's all kinds of things that you can do as a science experiment or math experiment that you can capture and then use that for your classroom. With the concussion thing also, about 2 years ago is when a lot of that started becoming popular in reading material for students. And as part of the Common Core, we have a lot of nonfiction reading pieces with that. And if you guys are familiar with Scholastic books, right, when you were like book fair stuff, they have a series of magazines that used to be like weekly reader sort of things, but there's one called Scholastic Scope, and it's for middle school language arts is what it's meant for. They also have one that's for health and all kinds of great things. They will actually work with a classroom to interview them or help get kids' stories to be put in this magazine for kids all over the United States to read. And there was a big push in there about the concussion issues, and essays were written for that and what parents have to do to protect their children if they've had a head injury to like not think. The idea is like to turn the brain off for so long just so that it can heal, getting a lot of sleep and so forth. Tapping into students' curiosities around sports, it's a great way for them to work into reading, writing, math, and science. So, you know, even though you guys were giggling on a couple of those ideas, these are very powerful ways to take kids' passions and help them love and learn again.
Yeah, and I think the giggling is kind of normal. You see that, I mean, when you get out and you have your own classrooms and you throw out projects, you know, there's going to be, you're going to see that giggling too, and that's okay. You know, but that doesn't mean that there's bad ideas there. I think that's just kind of, you know, that being afraid of that is something that new teachers often struggle with. You have to let things grow organically, especially when you're dealing with real problems in the world. And so you kind of have to work through that. And brainstorming and picking out what the good ideas are from the bad and separating those is a skill that we don't allow students to do nearly enough of. You know, so, you know, take a topic that may be a little controversial, that may, you know, cause some giggles in the classroom, and, you know, work through it. Have, you know, teach your kids to work through that and be, you know, a little more, and to grow their maturity as they're going through it. You know, some of those other issues were great too. You know, every one of those would make a great project-based learning or problem-based learning unit. And you could incorporate technology with any one of them pretty easily. You know, you just have to think about who's the most incredible person that we could talk to about this, and how do we contact them? How do we go ahead and find them? How are we going to present our findings? You know, so you've got a technology piece there, because, you know, the days of putting it on a poster board for your teacher and the rest of your classmates to see are over. You know, you're going to publish it in some way. How are you going to do your research? How are you going to communicate with other people that are doing research? You know, each one of those steps, technology is not, you know, you're not looking for a tool because it's cool or because it's engaging. You're looking for the best tool that's going to allow those things to happen among the people who are participating in the project. And so, you know, when we're talking about incorporating 21st century skills, it's not about let's use this because it's cool. The thing you're using may be very cool, the piece of technology, but the reason you're using it is because it allows you to do something that you couldn't do otherwise.
Mike, should we show them the Skype website for education?
Yeah, go ahead. Why don't you pull it up?
Okay. Have you guys heard of this one already, education.skype.com?
I've shared it with them way back when we've actually been week two or week three, because we did social media discussions and all, and it was in a binder with the Twitter and then all the Skype for Education, like you're saying, for you two, and then, of course, Connect, Google One.
Okay, the Connected Classroom. Okay, so, Mike, if you think it's okay, maybe we'll show them two or three of our favorites in here?
Yeah, that's cool.
Okay, so you guys all have devices on your machine right in front of you, your laptops, whatever. If you'll go to education.skype.com, we're going to have you browse with us. It's a little bit easier to navigate if we can kind of lead you and get you started. When you get to the website, it's education.skype.com. If you want to sign in, it's just your Skype ID. You can use a Microsoft login as well, but that gets a little on the sticky side, we've seen, so it's easier to have a Skype ID for that to play nicer. Then, when you get there, I'm actually going to have you jump clear to the bottom of the screen. So scroll all the way to the bottom, and then click on Partners. Skype has a partnership with several organizations, and there's more of these coming. In March, there is it's the middle of February till the end of March, is this big push on world literacy, saying that every girl deserves to read and every child deserves an education. Not just those who have funding and those that do not, don't get it. And it's really just incredible about what the power of reading and being literate does for an entire community. So you will see several more partners showing up probably about the middle of January, 1st of February. And there's going to be some really powerhouse people possibly coming on here, people like publishers who do the Harry Potter books in the UK. They're actually going to be some, like one of the partners in here, with the hopes that even the illustrator who does all the Harry Potter books will be doing Skype calls. And Mike, that's what I found out today, so I hope you're excited. But when you come to this page, you can scroll down, you can see some of the partners that are listed. Is there anybody, I won't be able to see you at the moment, but Dean, is there anybody in the room that's looking at something like computer science, a technology class?
To teach it?
Mm-hmm.
No, not really.
Okay. How many of you guys know the Hour of Code?
Nope. Crickets.
We haven't really touched on that much.
Okay. That's coming up next week. The idea that we can get kids excited about coding, computer game coding and so forth, which sounds kind of like uber nerdy, but it's something that they're making to be more fun. How many of you guys play Minecraft or know a brother or sister play it?
One
out of the whole room? You know, somebody, is there anybody that...
Hey, we've got two.
Okay, is there anybody who's actually seen it, even though you've never played it?
They better. If they ever watch TV, they ought to have seen it.
So you should know.
The majority of them raised their hand as far as having seen it.
Okay. So Microsoft, which owns Skype, they're doing a special piece between now and the next, oh gosh, Mike, is it just for December, or are they stretching it beyond December?
Yeah, I'm not sure the time frame.
Okay. Well, they have people who are supporting this whole coding mission into schools to get kids excited about computer science. And they have over 35 guest speakers working at Microsoft who work with kids. Some of them are project managers, so you don't even have to be in computer science, but you're talking about what does it take under budgets and taking ideas from the paper into an actual product. These people will do Skype calls with you. And when you click find a guest speaker, it will say, where are you? And I'll just drop Kansas here. And then go next. What age of kids do you want to work with? Now, Dean, I know a lot of these guys are just kind of in the beginning of deciding if I want to be a teacher or not, but what grades do most of them want to work with?
High school.
Okay, so let's go.
It's fairly evenly split this semester. Most semesters it's dominated by elementary.
Okay, so what was it?
Cool.
Then we decide, when are you available? Well, today's Monday afternoon. And maybe we could do Wednesday afternoon, hit next. Then there are 59 different people from Microsoft that could be working with you. Plus, you'll notice it tells what time zone they are in, so it's easier for you to connect with. Project managers, senior test lead at Skype, director of sales. So even if you're a math teacher, it has nothing to do with coding, you can find a connection for your classroom, a software engineer. So that's kind of slick, that direction. That's a new one right now. And Mike, I'm going to have you talk about the Night Zookeeper, but let me show you another one. Penguin Books, as in Penguin Publishers. If you click on View All, this is real authors and illustrators talking to your students. And Dean, a lot of these will actually do calls to your pre-service class to kind of tell them why they work with kids, and it wouldn't cost anything, so that might be something for you to tap into as well. And as you scroll down, how many of you read or at least remember Charlie and the Chocolate Factory?
I do.
Yeah? Okay.
Not so, the Tim Burton version, the original Roald Dahl version.
So Roald Dahl from Wales in England, and he has, okay, Wales is his own section of the UK, but aside from that, he has a museum there, and his daughter is somebody who's really been pushing getting his story out to the world, and she works with Google Connected Classrooms quite a bit, but his museum will actually run Skype calls to tell you about the author himself, some of Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, if they've been reading Matilda or James and the Giant Peach, all of these are his storylines. They will talk to them about the author, and that's pretty incredible stuff. Where some of the others, I'm going to scroll down to one called Just Jake. And this is Jake Mercionette. He is a kid who one summer his mom said, you will not sit around and watch TV and play video games all summer. You're going to write a book. He says, I'm writing a book? She goes, yes, your imagination's amazing. Let's write a book. Well, he does, and he gets published. And he will do Skype calls with students, and he's only 14 years old. He will talk to other kids and say, hey, I'm a kid just like you, and I've been published. And he's very animated and really gets kids excited about writing. And one last one up here called Me First by Max Cornell. This is a author and illustrator from California, and his event has ended just recently. But what he would do is get on a Skype call, and he actually would illustrate as he was talking to the students and actually give art lessons to kids virtually, and it was real powerful as well. So that's just a couple of them. Mike, if you want me just to be the navigator and just tell me what to type in or what.
Yeah, that's fine, since you've got your screen up there already. Why don't you go ahead and go to the Night Zoo, okay. The Night Zookeeper. And while you're doing that, I think there's, you know, there's something we need to mention. You know, how many of you that are sitting there, when you were in school, did really cool stuff like bringing in guest authors to speak to your classroom and working on big major projects with other classrooms around the world and solving real problems and those all these things that we're talking about here. I see one kind of hand going up.
Yep. Yeah. Just the one.
Okay. So then here's the question. When you become teachers, why would you teach like this instead of the way that you were taught in school? You know, and that's the thing that I struggle with when I'm working with not just pre-service teachers, but with teachers that are actually in the profession now. Like, why change? If it's been this way forever and it's worked pretty well, you know, why would we go through all the trouble of, you know, finding guest speakers on Skype or, you know, coming up with project-based lessons? You know, why change? And I'm actually throwing that question out to you. You know, someone give me an answer. Why do we need to do this?
Because, yeah, it may have worked, but it's boring.
I didn't quite catch it. Say it again.
He said it may have worked, but it was boring.
People just kind of go through the motions, like, we go to school because we have to. It's not, like, actually enjoyable to go. So if we bring those things in, it actually might make things exciting or make people want to come to school if there's a guest speaker. I know I would. So.
Yeah, good. So I think you hit on engagement.
Lucas,
you know, I think so.
Go back to some of the things you talked about with math side. What is it you want to offer that would get students going? He's shy right now. He's kind of lost the words right now, but when he and I have had conversations, he's been very passionate with what he wanted, the way he sees things. So.
Yeah, so Lucas, you're a math guy?
Yeah.
Yeah, me too. So here's what I saw in school, and maybe this is some of the same thing. You can tell me that if I'm you know, along the same lines of what you're thinking. You know, the way I was taught math, it was a series of rules to be memorized, and I did a great job of memorizing those rules until I had about trigonometry. And once I hit trig, I couldn't memorize all of those rules well enough to put them into place, and I didn't really have enough understanding of the math I was doing to know why I was doing it. And I actually thought that I was a pretty bad math student. And it wasn't until later on when I started teaching math that I realized that I think pretty mathematically. And, you know, we don't give kids the number sense and the understanding of what they're doing at the younger ages to be able to ever hit the higher math. And that's why in the United States only about, you know, 11 to 15% of our students hit physics and calculus, because they can't get through those hurdles that I'm talking about. Is that along the lines of what you were thinking, or not at all?
More along the lines of, I think we should probably take out calculators. That way so they can actually learn the basics before we start going on to that. But yeah, basically the same thing.
Yeah, I think we use calculators as a crutch after, you know, we've gone so long doing bad math instruction to kids that they haven't gotten the basics, and so we hand them a calculator and tell them, you know, to cover for our bad math instruction at earlier ages. You know, I agree with you there. But as the other student over there mentioned before, you know, engagement is one reason why we need to change things. Because, let's face it, traditional school is boring, especially to kids that have stimuli bouncing off them from video games and TV and all these other places. But I think more than that, it's a different world that we're sending kids out into than our teachers sent us out into. You know, think about what you do with technology in your everyday life. You know, how many of you have a smartphone? Laptop? Tablet? Okay. Tablets and smartphones didn't exist 10 years ago. You know, what's the world going to look like 10 years from now? You know, if you're going in to be an elementary teacher, which half of you are, you know, by the time you even become a teacher, you know, your kids are still going to have 10 years plus before they graduate. What's the world going to look like when they graduate? You know, I don't know. You don't know what it's going to look like. So for us to pump their heads full of knowledge and not teach them what to do with it doesn't make any sense. And so, you know, we've got to do things differently than they were done to us. I certainly wasn't taught how to use a smartphone in order to solve problems. I wasn't taught how to use a tablet because my teachers never even envisioned those things would ever become a possibility. So instead of teaching skills and knowledge the way we did before, we've got to start teaching how to problem solve and how to critically think. And I'm sure Dean's talked to you about all these things, you know, in your class before. So why does bringing guest speakers and authors and that into your classroom, how does that help in this? You know, and that's the piece that I think we need to give you along with the website. You know, so each of these guest speakers that's coming in is not coming in as a one-time, like, ooh, this is a cool experience for kids. It may be, but it's got to be part of a bigger system in your classroom. It's got to be a system in which your kids are empowered to use what they're getting to do something. So, you know, maybe it's they're Skyping with an author because they're going to be an author. And they need to know how to research and write a book, and so they're going to talk to that author to get the knowledge they need to be able to do that. Or, you know, maybe they're going to learn to code because they want to create apps. You know, because that's a business model that they want to go into. Or maybe we're just exposing them to those things so that they know what direction they want to go into. But when you're a teacher, you've got to kind of envision why you're doing these cool experiences. And you know, what happened with me is I started just doing them because they were cool, maybe 5 or 6 or 7 years ago. And I had to go through that evolutionary process myself of saying, okay, the engagement is better, but the learning is no different. I need to do something more than that. I need to make sure that my lessons are written in a way where I'm taking these engaging experiences and turning them into better learning for my students. Would you agree with that, Dan?
Oh, because totally, you can make a worksheet that bores. How many of you despise worksheet packets? Okay, like all of them, right? Well, the first mistake a lot of people use when they create technology lessons is they take those same worksheets and they make them digital. And they're like, oh, now look what I've done. I've infused this technology, but my friends, a worksheet is still a worksheet, whether it's digital or not. Would you agree?
The S of SAMR.
Yes.
Yeah.
And we still see that in classrooms today, which is sad. But I totally agree with Mike all the way around. You have to, you know, I used to work for the Disney company once upon a time, pun intended. So when I worked at Walt Disney World in Florida, one of my favorite things to do was to sit in the Magic Kingdom right when you'd walk in the door when I was off of work, and I would sit on the benches and watch people walk in because something was kind of interesting that would happen. You'd see, you know, the kids coming in and they're bouncing all around, and you see the mom come in. She's like, okay, children, come on, let's get going. And then here would come the husband, and you're like, oh, my gosh. I could be anywhere else. I could be fishing. I could be anywhere. But I could be at the Sandals Resort. I'm at Disney World, right? How many of you would think like that right now?
Yeah.
Okay. You'll be a dad someday. So when these families would come in, the dad would kind of see something over in the corner, and it'd be like Pluto or Chip and Dale, and he would go, oh, it's Pluto! Guys, kids, it's Pluto! I love Pluto! And he would turn 8 years old just like that. And I would watch it again and again and again. And it's not about the commercialism at all. Because you can play that card about the Disney World stuff and all of that. And is that there? Yes, that's true. But what you saw was somebody would change their mind and just have this big wide-eyed look about loving life again. And I was kind of addicted to it, like every day. So when I was working for there, my job was just to make people happy. If I could help them look at the world and say, you know what, I can get through yet another day by just doing something small in their life, then I had done what I needed to do for the day. And now that I'm a teacher, there's really not a lot of difference. I'm now in the inspiration business. I'm not the get happy business, but I'm inspiring children to reach above what they thought they could do and go above and beyond that. And, yeah, you were going to say, sir.
Go ahead, Jacob.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I just have, like, a question for you guys. So I guess what frustrates me about just education, period, okay, I can kind of understand in high school, yeah, you got to kind of learn the basics of everything and have to take all the classes, blah, blah, blah. But what I don't understand is, yes, I know a lot of people when they come into college, they don't know what to do. But some people do know what they want to do, like, right off the bat. So why the heck do we have to take these stupid classes that don't deal anything with what I'm going to be dealing with? I'm sitting there studying hard for a stupid class that I'm never going to use. Like, why do I have to know this long old equation to be able to teach a gym class? Like, it makes no sense to me. So I guess for the people that know what they want to do, why can't we go into college and get the classes right away so we can get in, get out, and get into our job, but instead we're stuck here for 2 years taking classes that I have no business taking? Like, this class is actually going to help me. I can integrate myself into my classroom. But then I'm
Browning
seeing other
points.
Stuff where it's like, what the heck? So I guess, what do you guys think about that?
Yeah, I'm a big believer in students driving their own education. And so, you know, I would tend to agree with you in a lot of what you said. Don't be hating on math, though, because math is great. So, you know, when it comes to those tough equations that you need to learn, you know, math is the language of problem solving. And the reason that we learn it, and I'm not saying the classes that you're taking, but the reason, you know, to defend, like, well, I never use algebra in real life, you know, why would I need it? You know, understanding math logically builds brain patterns, and studies have shown this, builds brain patterns that allow you to solve other problems. So there is a place for math, you know, somewhere in that world. But I agree with you that students who are passionate about certain things should be able to pursue those passions without being distracted by other stuff that we're demanding of them just because that's the way it's always been or because that's the way we want it to be. You know, kids who are passionate should be able to run with those passions.
And I'll be honest and tell you that if you're looking to be a PE teacher, the odds of you going in being a full-time PE teacher are, it's really difficult. You probably would get a half-time PE position, and then you have to be prepared to handle something else. And if you can handle those higher-level math, you can teach 6th, 7th grade math easily without having to get special certification. There was a lot of classes that I took, and like, why am I in the sociology class? Why am I in taking this other ridiculous, like, foods class? I don't teach, some of the topics. But I can tell you that every one of those, I've had to help a student tutor through something like that. Everyone. Yeah.
And here's the other thing. You know, Dyane was talking about watching the eyes light up of that father when he turned 8 again, you know, when they walked into the Magic Kingdom. You know, as a husband and a father, I was the kid bouncing around, not the father who turned 8 already. I was 8 before I walked into the door. Like, I get excited when I go to Disney. But, you know, as a teacher, your job is to model loving learning for your kids more than anything else. You know, that has to be the moment that you walk into a classroom and you become a student teacher or a teacher. You have got to model loving learning and getting excited about learning. You've got to be that father who's bouncing off the wall because he just saw Pluto. Only it's not Pluto you're seeing. It's some differential equation that you've got to solve because you've got to inspire your kids to want to solve it also. And so there are going to be things that you don't love learning that you're going to have to feign enthusiasm sometimes, or you're going to have to learn to make yourself love learning them for the sake of your students.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
Come on, some other questions. There's a lot of you in here that have got some bright minds. You guys are being awfully tired. Thanksgiving break hangover, obviously. I get a lot of shake of heads, yes.
Actually, can you do me a favor? Would you all just stand up?
Oh, already got the mo. Oh, come on.
Okay, I want you to separate yourselves by those who want to be elementary, middle, and high school.
Where's high school? Stay over here.
Kind of separated as it is.
We don't like you guys.
That's so well.
Okay. So, is there just one lone middle school gal there?
There is no middle school.
Now you got 50 the party of the sea right here. Elementary, secondary.
Okay. So now pair up in small groups.
Why? Pair up in small groups. Just do it.
So one elementary together, in pairs or trios.
Are you wanting them to cross?
No, same
stay
topic.
In their area.
Yes.
Okay.
But I need you to be facing someone.
Face to face. Kind of like pair and share, like we've talked about with the Kagan Cooperative Learning. Mm-hmm.
Everybody just looks super excited to be here today. Okay, so...
Two groups of four and two groups of three.
Duos? You know, duos or trios, what we need. Now, what we need is... what I'm going to do is use the timer because everybody uses their cell phone in education. Everybody does. I don't care if anybody says it, don't. And we're going to give you about... I'm going to give you just 30 seconds. And I need one of you to decide who's going to go first and who's going to go second. So make that decision now. Hey, Dean, the trio, I need you to go join them. So at least we're paired.
I'm getting ready to send you guys something.
Okay. So the person who's going first, in this 30-second time spot, you cannot stop talking. You have to keep sharing your information. I'm going to mute my side just so that we don't go too crazy. I can hear you, but you won't hear mine coming back. But 30 seconds of what kind of teacher inspires you most?
Like, you think about
who you think it could be a coach as well, but a coach or a teacher that, you know, like, I would do anything for that person because they inspire me to be great. I want you to describe that person to someone else. A, go now. Start.
Go
for my future in high school. He's also a basketball coach. He's very passionate. He's a hard worker. Welcome to the situation. He's a great coach. He put a lot of time into what he does. He talks to the outside
classrooms.
So does the service. He's a great coach. He's a great coach.
Okay, B, it's your turn. Begin.
And the other person, I have a teacher who loves having
I know you have a trio over there. You guys stay. Everybody else rotate and find a new person. You can go anywhere in the room. Find a new person.
Lauren! Lauren! Jumping there, Ashley.
Okay. Same question again. Time. You have to do it in 15 seconds. You have to say all that you did before, but I want you to bring it down and be more concise and do it in 15 seconds. Is that who's going first? A, begin. Three, two, one, and stop. Some of you were stopping way before 15 seconds. All right, B.
B, you'll go live.
B, begin. Three, two, one, and stop. Now, all of you guys come up towards the camera. Come up so we can see you.
Wait, yeah, right there. You don't have to clear
up. Thumbs up. I love it. Okay. Mike, I'm going to just guess that nobody here talked about the most amazing worksheet they ever saw.
Yeah, I would guess not.
And I'm going to.
Anyone? Anyone talk about their favorite worksheet?
No.
No. And I'm going to guess that nobody talked about the teacher that put the hardest essay question because they thought no kid could pass it was an awesome idea.
No.
Am I right to guess that, too? Mm-hmm. Do you remember that teacher?
Yeah.
Did that person ever inspire you to be good?
Oh, kind of. But I didn't think of it first.
But did they, you know, a lot of times that person who says, oh, these kids are stupid, I'll throw this, look, they don't know anything. Usually that kind of a teacher generally thinks he's the most important person in the room. And
well, you know that history government teacher I had in my senior year that told me to shut up, put my head down, because I proved him wrong on a question.
But the thing about that kind of a teacher is that he forgot that teaching actually starts with relationships. Then you move into putting in rigor and relevance and, you know, real-world connections and all of those things. But I'm going to guess that every one of you talked about the relationship you had with that teacher. Am I going to guess correct on that one?
Correct.
What did one of you guys throw something out? What was amazing about that person?
Passion.
Passion. Funny. Just like Mike just told you, that you have to love the content that you, I mean, you have to love it so that your kids will love it too. Something else.
Yeah, someone said you were funny.
Humor is critical in the classroom. If you can, especially kids who struggle with, I'm never going to get this, I'm never going to get this, if you can help them take that edge off with a little, not sarcasm,
yeah,
but humor to make them like, okay, I can do this, that is a magic power with kids. What else?
Putting in the extra time.
Oh. Because have you got that message yet, guys, that teaching is a 24-hour job, right? It doesn't end at 3 p.m., right, Mike?
Well, here we are at, you know, almost 9:30 my time, right?
Yes. And there's going to be times that you have to answer phone calls from parents at 9:30 at night. There are going to be times where a kid will send you a message in Edmodo or whatever tool that you're using and say, you know what, I don't know, there's been bad things that have happened at my house today, and there's no way that I can get this accomplished. Can you work with me to figure something else out? It's, my friends, you have to love your students. Love them in the way that you would love your own children, because they are your kids for a semester. And if they feel that you would go out of your way to do something for them, to go above and beyond, they will work above and beyond expectations for you. What else would you say, Mike?
Yeah, I think relationships are definitely important. You know, and the extra time that someone talked about, it's not the extra time so much as it's, you know, that person cared about you because they're willing to spend that extra time. You know, for me, our parent-teacher conferences were always the Tuesday before Thanksgiving. The hardest day of school for me every year was the Wednesday before Thanksgiving, because I would meet the parents and I would find out intimate details about those kids' home lives that I was teaching, and it would give me a whole new perspective on what I was dealing with in the classroom and why they were struggling to learn the things that they were struggling to learn. And it made me even more thankful on Thanksgiving for what I had, you know, with my own family. But, you know, never assume that a kid is learning, you know, not learning because they're lazy or, you know, because they don't want to. You know, there's always a story behind every kid. You know, and until you're willing to empathize and, you know, see what that kid is going through and help them through the problems that have nothing to do with the content that you need them to learn in order to pass that state test that's coming up or the unit test that's coming, you know. The content is what everyone expects us to teach, and it's the least important thing that we do. You know, those relationships that we build are what matters more than anything. And until you have those, as Dyane said before, the content doesn't matter. You know, we know that kids physiologically can't learn when they've got the stresses that they're going through at home. And we also know that in order for kids to transfer things to their long-term memory, they have to have an emotional connection with the content that they're learning. Which means if they're worried about getting hit at home or they're worried about, you know, not having enough food to eat, they may be able to pass a test for you a week later, but there is no way they're going to remember that information after that. It's why, you know, it's one of the reasons, you know, we were talking about math before. We teach long division in third grade and fourth grade and fifth grade and sixth grade, and it's in all of those textbooks because kids never have an emotional connection with long division, right? And so we have to reteach it how many times? How many of you had to relearn long division year after year after year before you finally got it? I mean, I know I did, right? Because, you know, it's just a series of rules that you're learning. So creating exceptional educational experiences and connections with your students is more important than any of the stuff that's in the textbooks.
Okay, would you raise your right hand? Raise your right hand. Now give someone a high five.
Hey, don't leave me hanging here. Don't leave me hanging.
Bam. And tell them you are awesome.
You are awesome.
Have a seat. Oh, have a seat. You can see. Go sit down.
Now they're sigh of relief there. Yeah. They're starting to sweat a little.
But you'll notice that we got you up and moving. When you see kids that are getting like the, oh my goodness, I don't think I can pay attention one more second, we get up and have kids moving every 10 minutes in the middle school. You get kids moving even in a 50-minute period, you get them changing the activities every 10 to 12 minutes, you can keep those wheels moving. And you, my friend, who want to be a PE teacher, you should know also the power of the brain moving, working better the more kids get up and move. So we are doing that in every class now as well. Plus it engages your classroom conversations a little bit better as well. Now, let's go back and ask the original question. Some of the topics that you guys have been studying about tech in the classroom. Is there anybody here that wants to do, like, social studies?
You have one.
Okay, what's your passion in social studies, sir?
World history.
World history side.
Okay, ancient history?
Yeah. Yes.
Which one?
Rome.
Rome.
Rome, okay. Mike, let's say you're getting ready to do something with Rome. What are the two or three things that come to your mind that you could be using with technology straight away?
Okay, just brainstorming right off the top of my head. Use Minecraft to build a replica of the Roman Colosseum and have kids take others on a tour through it using, you know, YouTube. Create a YouTube video where they're narrating a tour through the Colosseum. Bring in a Roman history expert through Skype. Skype in with a class in Rome and share information about your locations with each other. There's three right off the top of my head.
Google Earth virtual tours, SketchUp.
SketchUp.
Two more.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah.
And the other piece that I would add is have them look at some nonfiction and some fiction pieces. You may have seen the books. You may not. Or what is it? It's you wouldn't want to have been a gladiator. Have you seen these books? They're awesome. They're really like kids' picture books, but there's a lot of technical writing in it and a lot of really good research. And it's got these guys that are all beaten up by gladiators, and the odds that you would be put in with lions. There's just some really cool things. So I would have them create their own graphic novel to go along with a day in the life of a Roman citizen. Or you could run a mock debate over the beginnings of democracy. Just having them taking on different roles of that era to walk through the foundation of a government. And all of these, some use video, some use things like infographics, Skype. We've covered all kinds of ideas. Then we could look at the tech tools that make those things happen. Does that make sense?
I'm going to throw out another curriculum for you. The performing arts, whether it be music, choir, or theater.
Who in here is that group?
The other two are gone tonight.
Okay. What are you thinking? Elementary, secondary?
Be secondary.
Choir, band?
Theater.
Theater. Very nice, very nice. All right, Mike, you're up first.
Yep. So right now, just in music, we have a musical exchange going on where we've got a Skype-a-thon scheduled. Seven different time slots over the day where we're going to have three or four classes from around the world coming in each one of those time slots. So we'll have maybe three classes, one from Greece, one from Russia, one from here in Pennsylvania at 8:15. And they're each going to share three of their favorite songs, favorite holiday songs with each other, and explain why they chose those songs so that they've got a little roundtable discussion. We've also had video exchanges in different time zones. So kids will send maybe scene one of the play that they're working on, a performance that they've done, maybe a dress rehearsal, and they'll send that video to a different theater group in another location, and then that theater group will send, you know, the play that they're doing back, so that each of them can give, you know, critiques or pointers on some of the acting that's been going on in there. I've also seen collaborations where, you know, maybe you've got someone who's doing the score, you know, in one location, and someone who's doing the blocking in another location. Coming together to give pointers to, you know, to a production that's going on. I would think that video conferencing and using video technology would be real important for, you know, for that.
Most definitely. We've also done poems in two voices where you would think of kind of that ancient Greek mindset where you would have the main person in the chorus is in the background. Have one class be the chorus, have one be the main character, and have those go back and forth. They're just doing it digitally. In performing arts as well, having students put together their own short play, like a melodrama, and then having the boos and the hisses and all of that sort of thing coming across in a performance piece. And then with photography, there are the tableaus. Does this sound familiar, the tableau art pieces of people showing up in a scene with their bodies, creating props and things?
Does that sound familiar? Tableaus.
Like on Lizzie McGuire.
Okay.
Are you talking about like Lizzie McGuire?
Kinda. I guess you did something like that. But in the tableaus, you would have students create a scene. If you think of The Last Supper, that is a tableau painting. It tells a story, though nobody is moving. Characters being in
the art teacher.
And with the tableaus with students, you would have them create a scene. We're using the body. So let's say we're doing the Three Little Pigs because we all know the story. If you want to build the house, then the people have to come together and build a house with people. If it's the house of sticks, then it may look a little bit different than a house of bricks. Okay? And then if you need a chair, they sit, like they look like a chair. And eventually they build the entire scene, except it's people as props versus the original. Put a challenge out there to say, hey, we want to retell the story of XYZ. And then put it out there to see what other students can do to create that with people playing those roles. It can be done very quickly, and with photography, you can share it out, put it with a Twitter hashtag, and bam, you can have the whole story written in a day.
Well, and then just to add to your two side, then we'll get right back to you, is Rock Our World, where one group of kids start composing the music, you send it to the next, another group adds to it,
yeah,
until it comes full circle and you get an entire piece of music written. Go ahead, Miranda.
So, like, realistically speaking, in high school, I don't really see how I'm going to incorporate a lot of technology. I mean, yeah, besides, like, Skyping other people for, like, if we're trying to find out arts around the world. But other than that, I've been on stage since I was 3 years old, okay? And I've done all my knowledge did not come from a single drama class I took in high school. They all came from the acting camps and theater troops that I've been in. None of it, realistically, no one cares about theater, really, who come into a drama class. They just want an arts credit. So I feel my job as a theater education major would to be sparking the interest into students rather than throwing a bunch of information on how to do certain things that they use again after they get out of my classroom if they don't get the interest in it first. And from my experience with the numerous drama camps and the classes that I've taken, technology just complicates everything so much more than having a monologue book given to you instead of looking online or actually hands-on doing something with your score sheet with the teacher instead of doing things online. Online just complicates so much in theater. The technology side of theater would be tech theater.
Okay, hold on. I hear what you're saying, right? But you could substitute in math, social studies, you know, any subject area and say the same statement that you just said. And I think you would hear teachers all over the world say those same things right now. You know, social studies is great, but when I learned social studies, there was no technology, and I still loved it. And, you know, so I don't want to complicate it more by adding technology in for my students. Or when I learned math, yada, yada, right?
Well, even currently in my classes that I take here at Sterling College, every time we have anything with technology, you have to get the copyrights things, you have to get this, you only get sections of everything. Everything costs money when it comes to theater. Everything online basically costs money.
I think you're looking at online differently than how we're describing it, right? So you're right. If you're going to publish something online, absolutely, going to cost you money for royalties and all that, right? But you know, take monologue, right? Every play that I've ever tried out for, I've had to do a monologue for the people who are, you know, choosing whether or not I was going to get a part or not, right?
Yeah.
So when I'm doing that monologue back, you know, 15 years ago when I was, or 20 years ago, I'm older than I think I am, back when I was in college, right? You know, I was performing that monologue for other people and I was getting feedback from 1, 2, 3 other people because really no one else was interested, right? Well, I've got the ability right now to get feedback from so many more people than that right now with my monologue by putting it on video and throwing it out in circles where people care about theater. You know, something as simple as that makes my life easier. And, you know, what you've got to look at is, okay, look at big performing companies right now. If you think they're not using more technology than they were 15 years ago, 20 years ago, you're mistaken. You know, so you've got to find out what's going on in real theater production companies now, and you need to replicate that in your high school classroom.
And don't discount the idea that some of the drama league out of Broadway, they will do Skype calls to your classroom for free. And having somebody working on Broadway in theater talking to your kids, that's amazing. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's free. And that's in my price range. Is that in yours?
It's my favorite price.
Well, okay, final comments, thoughts, because I'm going to have to let you guys go. We got to touch up, wrap up a few things before it gets 9, and so I can get these guys out of here. So your last closing thoughts and ideas, Dyane and Mike?
Go ahead. Go ahead, Dyane. You go first.
I would say, my friends, teaching is the best job in the world. We get to work with the most beautiful people ages 5 to 18. And these people have yet, most of them, I would say, have yet to be jaded by what we see as adults. They need somebody who believes in them. They need someone who can challenge them in a way for them to say, you know what, I think I can do that. And you know what, I think I can do it better. If you allow me to be creative with this, maybe I could really rock this. So they need somebody to believe in them and to encourage them. And whether using technology or pencils or giving that high five to a kid, being a part of that and teaching is really incredible. And, you know, I can't imagine doing anything else. I talk about education at night. I dream about it. I read education blogs. You know, I probably need an intervention. But I would say that if this is something you really want to do, my friends, the students are out there waiting for you. Mike?
That's good stuff. I'll say this. I'll try and keep it short. You know, you when you become teachers, you know, every teacher I've ever met that went into the profession did it because they wanted to change the world. They wanted to help kids become amazing and inspire the next generation and all of those things that we talk about, right? So you get to do that. But you don't get to do it if you get jaded by the system and if you start conforming and teaching out of a textbook because people tell you to. You know, you get to do it if you model what you want your students to be. And that's, you know, creative problem solvers. So if you're going to let them be creative problem solvers and you're going to let them solve the problems of the world and you're going to model that yourself by showing how creative you can be in your classroom, you know, amazing things are going to happen for you. You know, don't be that, you know, don't ever be that burned out teacher that's putting in your time so you can get a paycheck. You know, remember why you chose to be a teacher for your entire career and go make amazing things happen.
And Mike and I both do love to brainstorm ideas with students, pre-service and teachers alike. So if you want to follow us on Twitter and then say, hey, I've got this crazy idea, I just don't know where to get started, or I want to connect with someplace in France or whatever, we can help you make that happen. I am Mrs. Smoke with an underscore, Mrs. MRS underscore Smoke, because the other one's a pothead, and that's true. So you want to make sure the underscore.
And she might be fun to follow too, but you know.
She'd be enlightening as well. And Mike, you are?
I'm at M Soskil. First initial M, last name just as it's written on the screen.
We'd be glad to work with you guys anytime.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, no problem. It's good talking to you guys.
Thank you. I'll catch you both later on.
All right.
Sounds good.
Bye.
All right, bye, everyone.
Take care. Bye.